Okay. This is June the 30th, 1964.
We've been talking about the dwelling places or the houses that they used to live back in, Now this time, well, as we say, talk on about the food that they have and didn't use. But anyway, in the beginning of it, they did raise, I'd say, the vegetables. And such as corn, pumpkin, and also beans of different kind of beans. Mm-hmm. And pole beans, as some they call them, and they were different varieties in that, and they were beans of different kind. Mm-hmm. But anyway, they understand, know how to put up food for themselves, just like you would today, you know, they put up a vegetable, thing like cattle.
When you say they put it up, what did you mean?
Yes, well, the way they put that up. Now, the story that I heard back yonder, that was before my time, that they have a way of putting things up. And they cook it, and they cook some of it, and some of it they dry.
I see.
You see, and they dry all that by the heat of the sun. They dry in that way. Especially the corn and pumpkin. That's the way they take care of that.
Would they cut the pumpkin up or what?
Oh, yes, they cut it up in strips like our. Well, they'll cut a pumpkin just in the shape the way it is and then just leave it in the ring.
Rings that follow the lines of the pumpkin, or rings around this way?
Well, the pumpkin would be, well, I would say this way.
Mm-hmm.
Then they cut it in two.
And cut it in two?
Yes, and then they cut it around. Uh-huh. Around
it. It follows those lines that are on the pumpkin then?
No, the other way.
Oh, like this?
Yeah.
Let's see now. This is the pumpkin.
Mm-hmm.
Which way do they cut?
No, this way? Way, crossways.
This way?
Yes.
Horizontal?
Yes, and then they cut
strips.
Mm-hmm.
And they would hang those out to dry.
Yeah, mm-hmm. They hang those out. The reason of that, they have long poles. They cut long poles.
Yeah.
Set the forks up there. They lay the pole, and then they ring them pumpkins over that pole, and then set them all way about 3-4 inches apart. See, that's where they.
What kind of a line were they using to hang the pumpkin on?
Well,
that elm bark?
No, I don't know whether they're using the line or not, but the safest way and the best way is to use a pole.
This
if you use
pole?
Line, they'll cut them.
Yeah.
The pumpkin in two and it'll fall to the ground.
Oh, that's true, because it's soft.
Yeah. So by that, they don't use no line, they use a pole.
Now, it's.
So, then the corn, well, they cook it, and they dry that, they shell it off the cob, and then they take a cloth and lay it out where you'll be safe. Well, nothing can touch it up, go off, anything like that. And then scatter the corn over there.
Mm-hmm.
And let that dry.
Mm-hmm.
And they watch that for maybe 2-3 days. They'll keep it laying it out in some every day around there, and they watch that. But so long it's so dry, well, mm-hmm. where do you keep from? Mm-hmm. And that's where they dry their corn.
Was this on the cob?
No, not on the cob. They shell it off the cob.
When it's wet? When it's green?
Yes, when it's after it's cooked, right there. You see, they get it when it's in roasting air. Then they cook it, you
and
see.
And they cook how do they cook it? They boil it?
Yes.
Or roast it?
Boil it.
In
what? And then, next, just like you say, they roast it. They roast some of it. Mm-hmm. Now that's a little different way from this other.
This other is boiling it, and taking it off of the cob, then laying it out on a cloth. Mm-hmm. What kind of a cloth?
Oh.
Made out of what?
Well, in them days, the story that I heard, they used buffalo hides or different kind of hides.
Oh, the hide.
Yes, and they use it. Well, they usually tan them hides for this purpose, sort of that purpose, and then like that. And they take care of all these stuff, and they like anything else, you see. One time, come to use them, where they take them out and use them, and they. So, in a way, well, about the meat, well, they have different kind of meat, such as buffalo meat in them days, and deer meat, and all that on there. They slice that, cut that up, and they just slice it. Oh, might say they bought, I don't know, about a quarter of an inch thick, or maybe a little thinner. Yes. And then they'll hang it up on poles again. You see?
Mm-hmm.
Let that dry.
Yes.
Cure by the heat of the sun.
How long did it take? How many days?
Hey.
How many days did it take to
Well, dry? It'll take maybe about 3-4 days, something like that, on there.
Mm-hmm.
And it depends on the weather, like on there, sometimes in order. But anyway, they take care of all that meat in that way. And then there's another way, and then they smoke it. They slice it, just like you're talking about, and then they smoke it.
How'd you do that?
Over the fire. And then by the heat of the fire, that meat is cured, you see, from there.
Was it in strips when they smoked it?
Yeah.
They cut it into strips for smoking.
And then some of it, they slice it in.
Any kind of wood they used for smoking? Any kind of a special wood used for fire?
Well, yes, they'd use a best wood to use even now, that's just blackjack.
Blackjack?
Blackjack wood.
Why?
Well, it holds coal longer and a lot of coal. It's the heat of the fire, not the blaze of the fire, but it's the heat of it.
You
see, and the smoke, you see, not blazing.
Burning up the meat, you don't want to do that.
So then, by that, well, the blackjack holds a coal, live coal longer than the other woods on it. Then next thing they use oak. Then to smoke, then use a hickory.
Well, would they dry it out using the blackjack and then smoke it with hickory? Was it two steps?
Yeah. All at the same time.
Oh, they had two kinds of wood in the fire.
Yeah,
they had two kinds of wood. Okay.
You see, they mix the wood while the fire is going.
There, that did it.
But then, that's where they cure their meat. By that, at times, when it's cured right, that meat will last for maybe 2-3 years.
With smoking? How about drying it? Would it last that long?
The same way.
It would, 2 or 3 years.
Yes. And then they season it with salt as they dry it, see? And then let it dry.
Where'd they get the salt?
Just like salt meat.
After they dried it, where did they keep it?
Well, they have a place where they which installed it that they made out of a bubble hydrogen.
What that look like?
It looked like it was made pretty in like a suitcase or something.
How big?
Well, in different sizes or something. Mm-hmm. Some pretty good size on
it. You better estimate it about 3 feet? 2 feet?
Yeah, about 2 feet or a foot and a half length.
Yes.
And they stored all that in that one.
How did they cut this and sew the corners together? What did it look like?
Well,
did it look like this?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes.
What was the top like?
Yes. They ring it. Yes, they lace that up, you see.
What's the top like? Was it a fold?
Well, they'll have a lid on there, nothing like that. Uh-huh.
And they could bring it over?
Yes.
And tie it here?
Tie it, yes. And the way they bring it up in the form of a box, you might say, you see, and with a lid on it, you see, and they tie it.
We've been forgetting the names of these things. What would that be called?
I can't think of it right now.
Think of it later.
Yes, I can't think of what this is.
Was this plain on the outside, or did it have any designs on it?
This one.
Did it have any designs, or was it just plain hide?
Yes, it'd just be plain hide.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can put design or figures if you wish to on there, but then they just, it could be plain too, running just plain hide.
Sometimes design. Mm-hmm. Okay, now you said buffalo and deer. What other animals did the Iowa hunt?
They hunt, well, in a small game such as coon, maybe. Rabbit and squirrels, thing like that on there. And so them things could be cured out just like any other meat on there and be put away on there. And also the fowls, turkeys, I guess. And
turkey?
Yeah, turkeys and wild turkey and duck and things like that on there.
Duck and turkey.
No, another thing they had wild hogs, they get damaged on it.
Was that here or up north?
Well, there wasn't, I don't know whether there were very many wild hogs up in northern countries or not, but here, there were.
Mm-hmm.
There
were plenty
of them. Yeah. Now, then they, a lot of people are wondering, and the question has been asking personally, different ones has asked me, where did they get their sugar?
Yeah.
And where did they get their coffee?
Yeah.
Of course, everybody likes all that. That's the reason they asked that question.
Sure.
I told them this. I said, yes. I said, that's sure. I said, they get out a certain time of year, and the people that know and understand back in those days, I said, they look for honey, wild honey.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And they'll find a swarm of bees where they call it honey. And they rob the bees on that. Poor little bees.
How they get it? Did they smoke them or what?
Well, there are some people that understand, know how to get that, and they go and get that.
Mm-hmm.
And they might cut a tree down or some way, and they drain all that honey out, and they comb and all, they see, and they, sometimes when they even, when it goes running out, well, they catch it. Well, in way, they take that and boil that just like you would anything else, you know.
I see.
Turn it into sugar, you see.
Uh-huh.
They watch that.
What do they catch it in? What do they...
Well, they have little pots of wooden...
Wooden pots?
Yeah, wooden pots or bowls or whatever you call them, you know. You see some of them now.
Yes.
So, and they have those, and they have some of them made, well, I'd say wooden buckets, you know.
Uh-huh. That's about how tall? How tall is that?
Maybe not so tall.
Mm-hmm.
And about maybe 12 inches tall,
mm-hmm,
or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then, they're in different sizes. You know.
Were those made out of a tree trunk?
Yes, yes.
What kind of a tree do they use?
Well, mostly they use ash.
Ash?
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
Or cottonwood.
What do they use for a handle?
Well, they use a lace of some kind of maybe deer hide or buffalo hide, you see.
Mm-hmm.
They use
Then they dry it out, the honey over a fire, they dry it out. And how would they store it?
Hmm.
How would they store the dried out honey sugar?
Well, after they put it in, getting sugar, you mean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, how'd they keep it?
Well, they go right back to them with little wooden bowls and buckets.
Mm-hmm.
And then
what's
coming in, they have lids for them.
Yeah, lids for them,
mm-hmm,
to keep the ants out.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
They put their sugar in there. Then they have some that they lace. Deer hide, they lace them up.
Buckets?
Yes, and make a kind of a little
wood skin.
And then they put that sugar in there, and it'll keep them. They don't want just the little small ones, you know, on any container. But hold, maybe I'd say maybe 2 cups of sugar, and then each one. That's
good.
So now then, that's where they get their sugar.
From honey.
Mm-hmm.
From
honey, yes.
What did they eat it in?
They get out in the woods. They, yeah, they do.
How did they eat it? How did they eat it? What did they eat it on? The sugar.
Oh, they use it for sugar. They use the sugar for different things, such as we're saying coffee to sweeten something the pumpkin. Little in their corn. And then they use it for different things like that, don't they?
Okay.
And maybe they might want a piece of sweet bread sometime where they make a little of that. And corn bread, you know, they.
But sugar and all those things.
Yeah.
Now, when was that? What time were they doing that?
Well, that was before my time, but I couldn't say, but that's the way they come, far as I can remember.
Yeah.
But I have seen a little of it during my time since
during
I
time. Mm-hmm.
Got old enough, big enough to understand what
mm-hmm.
things on that. Now then, coffee, the way I understand, that I didn't see that, that I have seen, but mighty little of that, they go down here and get these big acorns.
Acorns?
Mm-hmm. And grows on that.
What kind of an oak?
They grow on these oak trees, big oak trees. I think they call them oak trees. And them acorns are pretty good size.
That big?
Yes, about that big.
How big is that?
Well, I don't know. That's about an inch and a half.
That's
some of them a little smaller.
Inch and a half, but that circle you were making,
mm-hmm,
that's about 3 inches.
Mm-hmm. There is some. But now I don't hardly see any now.
You mean they make coffee out of acorns?
Yes.
How do they do that?
Well, they take that and parch it, like.
Parch it, huh?
Mm-hmm. Yes, they take that and take the meat out of the hull, like you see.
And throw the hull away.
Yes. Then when they hull that, it ain't big as we say it is.
No.
You see, they get the heart, you know, and all that, and then that's what they use for coffee. They port that till it turns brown, and then grind it up, and then make your coffee.
How?
Well, just like we do now.
They
throw
it in the water.
Yeah.
Well, how do they boil things? What did they use to
boil
things?
They use these iron kettles around there.
Mm-hmm. What I wonder what they used before they had iron kettles that the traders brought.
Well, they claim that they use a certain kind of clay to make pots out of.
Did you ever see any of the Iowa pots? Did you ever see any?
No, I haven't.
Mm-hmm. You mean the Iowa took clay and they made pots?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what they looked like?
No.
You never saw one?
No. What I've seen, really, the way they are, mm-hmm. is plenty of shape of some of these pots we have now, these iron pots. You know, but the bottom of it's kind of round.
Can you draw that? That's very important.
Mm-hmm.
Would you like to draw a clay Iowa pot?
Well, in a way. Wait a minute, I'll let you draw it on there.
Okay.
It would be, we'd say that'd be the top, you see, and then they'd mm-hmm. bring it down to here, flat, let's say,
mm-hmm.
to that point. Now that would be, I can't draw very good. But anyway.
You're fine.
Yeah. Well.
Was it flat on the bottom?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, it's flat. But it's
now then
that's just the way they draw it. Then they get a certain kind of a clay to make
mm-hmm.
it.
Do you know where they found that clay? Was this up north? Was this up north before they came here?
Yes,
After.
Well, here they found it here and before that's what they use up there too.
So they were making pots when they came here.
Uh-huh.
Clay pots.
Uh-huh. Before they came here, they had clay pots and things like that on there.
How big were these pots?
Now later on, after they came here, or before they come here, when the white people began to come in, well, that's time they began to get these other pots, you see.
Uh-huh. And iron too?
Yes, iron pots. Mostly in iron pots around there. That's what they use to heat the water. And still, they know and remember how to put the food up and cure it and all of that, and then they use all this. And then.
Which of these shapes is most like it?
Yes, just about like it.
Which one? This one or this one?
Well, this here one here.
This is more like it.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't like that.
And then, this here, it could be a little lower too, you know, kind of.
Okay.
Different heights of what I'm talking about, and different like that.
Like that?
Oh, yes. Yeah, like that.
What color?
Well,
red.
It kind of depends on what kind of a
mm-hmm.
Clay that they get on there. There is some gray looking, white looking clay, and then there's some red looking clay.
Or red.
Yeah.
I wonder if any of those pots are left.
Hmm?
Do you think anybody has one of these pots?
I don't think I have. That's the reason
I say. It should be good to take a picture of it.
Like I said a while ago, I don't know whether there's mm-hmm. anyone got any or not on there. Mm-hmm. I've got one. Seemed like everything that they did have, thing like that, they all gone. Somebody's taken on mm-hmm. on that. What I mean, you know, they come along and pick them up, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
70s places, like down here to Oklahoma City or other places on there.
Yes, a lot of things went in.
So now they,
we've got the acorns for coffee.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they force that just like they would there. Well, you seen green coffee on here, sir.
Yeah.
You can force that just the same way on there. Force that mm-hmm. on there. Then they make coffee out of it.
I wonder
and then
what that tastes like.
Now the tea, they have certain root.
Oh, really?
Yes, and
there's
certain weed that grows. I don't see any now, them weed that they make tea of. There may be some somewhere, but I haven't been able to see any around here close anymore.
Did your mother use it?
Yes.
Your mother used it?
Yes, they used it on there.
They called it tea?
Yeah, they call it tea.
Can you describe the plant?
Hmm?
Can you describe the plant?
Well, yes, it looks, the color of it, instead of a light, a dark green or a light green like that, it's gray looking.
Gray looking?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like sage?
Yes, uh-huh.
That color?
Mm-hmm. But the leaves are different from that, you can tell.
I see. Were they bigger leaves?
Mm-hmm. And then it has limbs on it, and they're like...
How tall from the ground?
Oh, maybe...
2 feet?
About 2 feet.
Mm-hmm. Any flowers? What color flowers?
I believe that. They're purple.
Purple?
Mm-hmm, purple flowers, and the white flowers on it, little blooms on it.
Got two colored flowers?
Two colors on them, yeah.
Well, that ought to be able to distinguish it. Mm-hmm. Somebody should know what that is.
Well, you might. Yeah.
We'll look in the book, see if we can find a picture of it.
Okay.
Did they use that tea up north?
Yes, they used that for tea.
Up north? Before they came
yes,
here?
Yes, and then here too. Yeah.
What'd you say about a root?
Huh?
You said something about roots. Did they use something for drinking from roots?
Or oh, yes, after other, yes. Yes, they use that, they call it sassafrass now.
Ah, yes.
You see, all this was a second, and that's that wild plant from us here. That's what they use.
Sure. Anything else?
Well, I guess that's all in that line there.
Okay.
You know,
Any more, let's see, sugar, coffee, wild hog, turkey, duck, buffalo, deer, beans, pumpkin, and corn. How about green vegetables? Green vegetables.
Oh, yes.
You didn't mention any of
that. Yes, they do use that green vegetable, just like, now. Now, since they come in here during my time, well, I notice that the things change little. Of course, you take a lot of the articles that they didn't have come in, you see, in those years, and also that, of course, there were plenty of wild game here in Oklahoma when the folks come in here.
Yeah.
Even up to a few years after I was old enough to remember, I'll bet. I've had deer meat, wild hog, and also my turkey and all that, and I had plenty of squirrels and rabbits and all that, fish and things like that.
Fish?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. That's my name. And these big streams. But since they were able to go and get these equipments that they use, like it is now, it's more so now than today than it was then, but still they were getting stuff in from somewheres, and they get their stuff through, as I said here some time ago, through an Indian trader.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, now then, that's how come they took care of their stuff, and of course, there's more to it and all that, but then I can't think of everything right now.
Of course,
and then I take a back yonder before my time. Well, I'll have to kind of think of them.
Yeah, we can do that.
Like stories, you know, and things like that. The history I'm talking about on there, because I remember that. No. Now.
How about nuts? Nuts. Do they use any nuts from the trees, like walnuts?
Yeah.
What kind of nuts?
What I'm thinking about is hickory nuts.
Hickory?
Yes, hickory nut, walnut, acorns, and also the wild fruits such as crab apples and gooseberries and dewberries and blackberries and wild cherries, and things like it.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's another berry, well, anyway, wild strawberries.
Oh, yes.
Yes. strawberry. This other berry.
Elderberry?
Yes, no, wild. This is all wild berries, yeah. You see, on there.
How about grapes?
Grapes, there's plenty of that from the grapes on there. Mm-hmm. You can find grapes out here on upland.
Now?
Yeah, I imagine there is if the frost hasn't killed them. But anyway, they're a little smaller.
Mm-hmm.
But you go down on some river,
mm-hmm.
it seems so you can find bigger grapes down there that grow along the river from the banks from there. So they have different mm-hmm. fruit like that.
Did they eat the fruit just the way it was, or did they dry it?
They dried, yes, they dried it on there.
They did?
Yeah, they dried that and take care of that just like any other food, you know, on there, just like mm-hmm. I was saying.
You can't dry all of those berries, can you? You can't dry strawberries.
Well,
what berries did they dry?
You know they're drying that prunes now.
Yeah.
And raisins and all
yeah.
that. Well,
mm-hmm.
that's just about the way they're done.
Some of those fruits they could dry.
Yes, uh-huh. And the grapes, they can be dried that way. Crab apples and all
mm-hmm.
that. And then, raspberries.
Yes.
Now, I can think of that.
Mm-hmm.
And dried raspberries, you can't beat that.
Oh, I bet they're good.
I mean, they cook that and mix it up, like where they do in cobbler.
Oh.
They
did they make that kind of thing?
Oh, they make that kind of thing.
And did they put dough in with it?
Yes, they fix up that dough and all that on there and they make that up. And then they also, I don't know whether you ever had taste any of that or not, but they also make a, what's called meat pie.
No. What's that like?
They grind the meat up and they cook it like on Sunday. And dough and this fixed it plain by which they do it is like pie. They season that before they go.
What they put in the, what they use for seasoning?
Seasoning, or they use for salt. Seasoning.
Salt?
Yes.
What else would they put in there besides meat?
Well, there's a certain kind of weed that they could, they did have. I don't know the name of that.
What did it look like?
Well, in the way I'll go back again.
You're going to be a botanist.
yeah, it looked like a, like we were talking about a little sage.
Sage,
yeah, it never looked like sage, mm-hmm. but it was not sage mm-hmm. at all.
This wasn't the same thing they used for tea, was it?
Yes.
You mean it's the same plant?
No, it didn't. It's a different plant.
Oh.
And,
mm-hmm.
and I was thinking about some of that the other day, well, I could find some of that. I don't know where to go and find it. There's a lot of stuff like that. It's gone, you must
say. I know it.
Yes. And then. But I seen some of those plants before it was all destroyed. Now how come it's all gone since they began to
mm-hmm.
put this country in cultivation on using my sage on there and all that? That's where it went.
Was this a plant that grew in the woods or out in the open?
Well, yes, I kind of hope in the garden. You might be lucky enough to find something in the woods, or it grows anywhere.
It grew anywhere.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Especially along a creek like that.
We ought to go down to the creek sometime and see what's down there.
Yeah,
we might. See if we can find some of these old plants.
Might be, yeah.
And make a record.
Some of our own prayer mm-hmm. like that.
Well, we ought to have a plant expedition someday when you feel real good.
Yeah. Then there's another plant again, wild plant. We call that Indian potato.
Oh?
It grows and under the ground
uh-huh.
and it's all linked up on a little root.
How big is the potato?
Well, about that big.
Oh, 2 inches?
About that
inch,
big ground.
Inch,
and then there'd be a little root.
Yeah.
About here. Then there'd be another.
Another little potato.
Uh-huh.
What color were the potatoes?
They're brown.
I think a lot of Indians use that. I think the Blackfeet and the Crow used it up in Montana.
Yes. Yes, I imagine.
A lot of Indians use that.
And then they also got that, and then they have another plant again. It grows out in the prairie. They call that a turnip, Indian turnip.
Indian turnip?
What we call it. Yeah,
what's it look like?
Yeah, different sizes, you know.
What color?
They're brown, but when you peel them off, they're white.
What do they do?
Will
they dry it or cook it?
They can dry that. Mm-hmm. They can dry this potato. That's mm-hmm. what we were just not talking about. They can dry that
mm-hmm.
and put that away and use it anytime they want. And then there's another plant again that grows in the water. And I'll call them water lilies. You know,
oh.
They're root down there.
Uh-huh.
And they go down in the water there and follow there. The stem, you might say, you know.
Yeah.
Down to the root. And when they pull that root out, it looks like a banana.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. What color?
Well, yellow.
Yellow?
Yeah, some of a little deeper
mm-hmm.
color than yellow. And then they take them, clean them, then they dry them. You know. And that's something good to eat, but it's a little work to all of this, you know. Mm-hmm. All that.
Oh, I should say. It was a tremendous amount of work to dry all those things.
Mm-hmm. And but they're great hand to dry and cure their food in that way because mm-hmm. you'll keep.
That is important.
Keep forever, yes, mm-hmm. on there. And for that reason, well, another thing again, they're great hand to smoke a lot of this food. Because the way I learn and understand, I have seen since my time, smoke a lot of stuff like meat especially. Mm-hmm. I don't know, but they say it's healthy for you.
Oh, yes.
Yes. You can taste it in the meat or you can taste it in the soup.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
That's good.
Mm-hmm. Good. So that's reason.
Mm-hmm.
They're great handful that all did. Mm-hmm. Of course. Time to see, well, they're bringing fresh meat. Oh, well, they're going to have fresh meat.
Mm-hmm.
It's nice to eat them, but all that, but mostly it's all dry.
Mm-hmm. What's left over? What's left over?
Mm-hmm.
When they eat fresh meat, and then what's left over from the buffalo, while they dry it,
yes.
smoke it,
yes.
and store it.
Store
it,
yeah.
Was there ever a time here? When they came here, when they didn't have enough food, I mean, when maybe their store of food would run out, they wouldn't have enough to get them through the winter or the spring?
Yes, they try to put up enough food to last them through the winter and summer and all season.
Mm-hmm.
Now when they begin to, might say, get to run low on their food, that's time you hear of people, some people say, well, they're going out on a buffalo hunt.
Yes.
You see. And then, which they do, and then also they go out on deer hunt,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
things like that. When they, because of course, while they're out hunting, well, they have to have something to get along on, to eat on, all that. Of course, but still they go out. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Then they don't kill. Just what they think is. It would do them for maybe another 6 months, a year, might save them, and then let the rest go, you see.
How many buffalo hunts a year did the Iowa have up north?
Well, the way I understand, about twice a year.
Twice a year?
Uh-huh.
When?
There's one in, you might say, during the fall time, one in early in the spring, you might say. So then, they may have plenty left, but still they won't have plenty on hand, so
yes.
they won't run out mm-hmm. when they. But so in a way, well, they keep a track of everything in that line. And they try to keep plenty on hand
mm-hmm.
all the time.
Mm-hmm. When you were little, What sort of foods did your mother have around the teepee?
Well,
Do you remember?
Yes, I remember something. They had the vegetables. They even got out and made garden courses.
Oh, thank
you. See, it was more handy then on that day to make garden. They put up stuff, but she did.
When she put it up, she dry it?
Well, some of it and some of it not, in cans on it.
She canned it?
Yes.
In glass
cans? Well, I say canned, yes, glass on the jar, something like that on there.
And she kept those, where did she keep those? In the teepee?
Yeah. And then there, they began to raise such as beet or something like that, and all of that on there.
Beet?
Beet, cucumbers, and all that on there. Like about the way they do now on there. But
they hadn't done that before, though, had they?
No, they didn't do that before.
They didn't use those vegetables.
But as I say, it says, from there, and beet and cucumber and all that from there, well, things like that, and then the green beans, as we say, and black wax, and cut beans or something, I don't know what they call it, anyway, green beans, you know. Well, they didn't do that before on there, but which they did have beans and all that stuff, but they put a different way from it on there.
What did your mother cook on?
She had pots just like the iron kettles and things, like skillets and all that, and it was just iron.
Outside?
Yes.
Well, suppose she's going to can something. She's going to can some beets. Did she ever can beets? She cooks them in the iron kettle. Does she use the glass jars and the rubber ring? And then the lid? About what year was that?
Well, I'd say back, well, I can remember it back in about 18. I don't know how long she'd been doing that before, but as I can remember it about long, about 1800. And then I'd say it on 9 to 5. See all that, and then as it went along, as I say, well, I see a little more of it in different ways.
Things kept changing.
Yeah. And then.
I don't see where you'd keep those cans in a teepee.
Them cans?
Yeah, those things that she's, those canned beets or whatever she made. You know, when she cooked them and put them in the jar. Where did you keep those jars?
Well, she keeps them in the cellar.
In the cellar?
Yeah, and then maybe they might have a dugout. They put them in there, you see.
Yeah.
They all say, I don't know, they're best to put them in a dark place.
That's what I've heard.
In a dark place or somewhere, and so they keep and keep a long time with that as they do on that.
Was she canning when you lived down on this, where is it, over there? In that village?
Yeah.
Was she canning then?
Yeah.
Did you have a garden over there?
No.
No garden there?
No. We're not right where the village was.
No.
But there's garden, they had garden this way on the hill, like from that village.
Oh, up on that hill?
And then, of course, they do have garden spots like that, like you say. Like here, when the house used to stand over here when Grandpa was living on this place where they had garden spot down there.
Down by the river?
Back straight near south of the corner there, back down there. That's where they had their squaw corn and all that.
What's that?
That's an Indian corn, squaw corn, the same thing.
What color?
Oh, there's one blue, one white, and speckled, and one red. It's 4 different colors.
Did those colors mean anything?
Well, I don't know whether.
Okay, we wait.
Well, yes, it does mean the way they understand. Maybe I might go into that later on.
Okay, fine. We're just talking about food now.
Yes.
What was the name of the grandpa that lived here?
Betwin Hollowell.
This was his land right here.
Hmm. Yes, this was his land. He owned this down here. And he lived here, and then later on, well, mm-hmm. he built another house up there, and then moved up there.
Up on that hill?
Up on that hill. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That's where he lived on.
You want to stop now?
Well, okay.
Okay. It's 4:15.
Yeah.
So we can quit now.
Mm-hmm. All right.
So you don't get tired. And if you think of any more about food, well, we'll go on next time.
Yes, and then maybe we can.
I'll think of some questions.
Pick up.
Yeah.
One of them. There's lots of things to think of and all that, even during my time.
Yes.
There's lots of things that I see that I can't just think of right offhand on that.
Can we do one more thing today?
Right.
Can we do one more thing? And that is to give the Iowa word for these vegetables and meat, you know, in the language.
Well?
Like the word for the different kinds of beans, the Iowa words. Do you remember those words?
No, I got to.
Well, you'll be thinking about
that's just what I'm going to say, you see.
All the Iowa words for food that you can think of, buffalo and deer and the different kinds of buffalo and sugar and coffee and tea and pumpkin. I'm sure pumpkin had words in the Iowa. Okay.
Yes, it'll do that. Of course, I'm not saying that I don't know, but I just got to think of them.
Oh, yeah.
Give
well,
a correct
you
name
haven't
of
thought
them.
Of those words for a long time.
Yeah. To give the correct word, the name of everything. Aha. That's it.
What? What'd you say?
Aha.
Ha.
They use the same word, but there's a little tuning that's a little different.
Uh-huh.
That's one thing on that.
Do you know?
So when you can hear a woman talking over there, and you can identify it's a woman talking over there. And then when a man talks, you can identify it's a man talking.
There's a difference in the sound.
Yeah, but I just can't explain that part of it.
Uh-huh.
There's a little difference in. Uh-huh.
And you never learned the woman's tune, did you?
No.
Oh, my.
But I might can imitate, but I'm not a woman. That
no, it'd be different.
Yeah. But nowadays, a lot of don't know the difference of that.
No.
And
does your sister know?
Yes, yeah, some talk like some women. They try to talk like men.
They don't know the difference. Does Let's see, does Rachel know the difference?
Yes. Yeah.
Who's your sister?
Yeah. She knows the difference. And, well, all of my sisters, they know the difference.
Mm-hmm.
Brother, too, know the difference. But there is something that they would ask me if it was correct or not.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if it's correct, I'll tell them yes. If it's not, I'll tell them no. Now, then. There's a lot of them, as I start to say, well, they don't notice that difference.
No.
They say, well, yes, I talk Indian and all that. Well, yeah, sure, I guess they can. But coming down to the senses of the words of what the Indian uses, all that, there is a little catch I might say on there, as I was trying to explain how it goes by.
Yes. Is this on every word? There's a difference on every word. A woman speaking has a different thing that she puts on, say the word dog or the word horse or the word run. Why don't you give me an example of two sentences saying the same thing, but one the way the man would say it and one the way the woman would say it. Give me the example, see if I can tell here the difference.
Now they use the same word. They call a dog the same, both man and woman, but there's a little.
What is the difference? Can you say it?
Well,
a man said dog. Say it for me.
Okay.
That sounds good. Now how does a woman say it?
Well, they say the sunkey, it's the same thing, but I can't explain that. The tone of the woman speaks, it's just
it's different, the tone.
Yes, just a little. They use the same word to call a dog and all that.
All right, what's the word for man? What's the word for man then? If a man says it.
Yeah, the man is could say wonga.
Okay.
Wonga.
What does the woman say?
And the woman, he knocked her.
Now is that the word for man?
Well, they use the same word. When you call a man, you say wonga. And then the woman uses the same word to call a man, you see.
And she says what?
Wonga. Wonga.
Wonga.
And then the man. And use the same word, woman.
Mm-hmm.
But
there's something different.
Well, I don't know. Just like I say, it just leads back into the tune.
Yes. Uh-huh. Well, now that's something that's very good.
And that tune, I don't know. The little difference in. But in a way, well, I just can't.
Well, maybe we'll get into it
sometime.
Well, I'm going to turn it off now. 5:00. July 2nd, 1964. Iowa Community Hall.
Oh.
Okay, now.
Well, I would talk a little about my grandfather, which I haven't seen. That is my father's father.
Mm-hmm.
And but the little story that I have of him, it was through my father.
Yeah.
And here after they arrived in the state of Oklahoma now, then it was territory, Indian territory.
Yeah.
And in a way he come into this country about long in 1871. Country here, the Indian Territory was wild. No settlement, but nothing but Indians. That's the reason they call it Indian Territory. Well, it's naturally that they like to live out, I might say, in kind of a wilderness or something where it's wild, where they can find wild game so they can live and have a good time hunting and all that. It's quite a sport. Wild games and all that. And they also where they are for the food and have a good time too, running, killing wild games on that. Well, when they come into this country in that year, and later, he passed away about around, I'd say, in around about 1889, along in there, and which is before my time. But he passed away and lived down here near north of Wellston, Oklahoma, down here on Deep Fork River.
Yeah.
There. And they occupied, I might say, about a 2/4 mm-hmm. of a land down there along there. Deep Fork River on the north bank, where they can graze their ponies and all that, and then where they can farm little stuff, little ground where they can raise vegetables and make their living. And, well, they lived there, made a home there, and all there. Now then, later on, somehow he got down and got ailing. But in those days, they lived quite a while after they began to fail in their health and all that. And I was taking that one, but finally he died. And in other ways, they, first they, dad and mother and grandma understood that for some kind of his age, I kept him there.
Do you know, about how old was he when he died?
Well, we can figure now, as to say he was born back in 1820, as long as it, but I don't know just what year, but mm-hmm. up till 1889, now you can figure that out just about how old he is from there.
Well, let's see, that would be about 69 years old, about 70.
Yes, mm-hmm. it might be long, just about maybe 69 or so. But before I go any further, let me reach back. During his young days, or back younger, I don't know just as I live, just where he was born. But as I have mentioned, his name, his English name was Thomas Nino, and his Indian name was Blackwing. So, going back in those days, I don't know just where he was born, but it might be in the state of Missouri, as which it is called state of Missouri now, or in the state of Iowa back in there.
Mm-hmm.
Near some river back there, I don't know which river it would be, whether it would be the Illinois River or Mississippi River alone. Of mm-hmm. course, in those days, they're not in state as we call states now, and it was really open country just like it was here.
Mm-hmm.
So by that, well, that's where I understand that he was born back in those. In that part of the country, I would say, that which is known as a Missouri and Iowa state. No,
it's all right, Alan. This tape seems to be stuck here. I'm trying. And I think it's all right now. It was catching.
Oh, was it?
It's okay now.
Now, as I were talking about back in those, which is knowing, as I say, is Missouri and state of Missouri and state of Iowa back in there. Then from there they come in to which is knowing as Nebraska and Kansas at the present time. That reservation up there, knowing as Iowa Reservation, near, well, I'd say, bank of the Missouri River, on the west side of the Missouri River, on the bluff there near White Cloud, Oklahoma.
White Cloud
and Rulo
mm-hmm.
and Hiawatha and Fall City in that area.
That was it.
Yes. That's where they settled after crossing the Missouri River back this week. Now then.
About what year was that? Do you know? About what year?
Well.
Let's see, that would be.
I see. That would be about long. Well, it must be long in about 1830, so I'm there, somewhere going there. Anyway, it's long, about in them years, I would say. But anyway, they, while they're living there on that reservation, the Civilian War come in.
Civil? No.
That's the Civilian War, as I would say, when the North and South were fighting. One of his brothers were in the service. He volunteered to go in the service.
His name?
I don't know his English name. And his Indian name was Wakanta.
Really? Same as that?
Yes, that's his name. So you can see the names that we carry, you can see what it means.
They're great names.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So in a way, he volunteered. That's when they call for volunteers. So he fought on the north, again the south. Okay. That's what they call it during that time.
Mm-hmm.
During them years in the battle, it seems so that he served some parts in this country here.
Wakanta?
Yeah, here.
He came to Oklahoma?
Oklahoma Territory.
Well.
And also in Arkansas and back into Tennessee and back on there.
Mm-hmm.
Well, just in the service, army. So by then he noticed that there were Indians here, and wherever he went, there were Indians here and there in different places.
Mm-hmm. Are you talking about Wakanta now?
Yes.
Okay.
Then he, after the war was over, or right when he got home, told the family, he says, "I seen, different country." And must say, that's Indian word. While I were in service, as we went along, as I noticed there's Indians here and there. And also I noticed the country. He said, same so, there's a plentiful of everything, such as wild games,
mm-hmm.
all that.
Mm-hmm.
And some beautiful land, which they call Indian Territory. Then they talked it over after so long that they decided to come down and see.
Now who were they? Who were they?
There was my grandpa.
Oh, Mrs. Thomas.
And his brother.
And his brother Wakanta.
Now, there I forgot, as I say, I forgot his name.
His English name.
Yeah. Now then, yes, they did come down here.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, they found wild game and plentiful.
Just two of them come, or did they bring their families with them?
Well, no, yes, they did. They brought their families with them,
mm-hmm.
and then they sent the word back up there that they were plentiful of wild games and
mm-hmm.
also good country to live and all that.
Well, what was wrong with the country they were in? What was wrong with the area in which they were living up there? What was wrong with it?
Nothing wrong, only just there was no wild game like it was here in Oklahoma, and they were really, really half a wild game. You know,
mm-hmm.
That's what they were.
Okay.
The wild games, all that was plenty all gone up there where they were.
Mm-hmm.
But the wild games weren't brought them
mm-hmm.
here.
Well, now were either of these men chiefs?
Yes. Yes.
So they could make the decision.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, they were the chief of what they call the Eagle Clan. The clan, the name of the clan is Wakanda Kigracha.
Say that again.
Wakanda Kigracha. That's
Wakanda Kigracha.
Yeah.
Now what does Kigracha mean?
That means, in a way, it's kind of hard to explain.
Yes.
Wakanda means God.
Mm-hmm.
The servants of God, you might say. I'll explain it that way, so it can make it give a little understanding or anything. So by that, in that way, that's how come we got all these names. And the few words of the clan, I will say, that which they have learned and understand, and they believe and know and understand, that the leading of the fowls of the air was the eagle.
Yes.
Next to the heavenly things.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's the reason that we call ourselves the Eagle Clan. But that, and that's all combined in the heavenly things, of all things, right?
Mm-hmm. That's a beautiful name.
Yeah. So now as I say, they come into us in the Oklahoma Territory in them days and back in those days. They come into this country and found things like they thought they would, and they sent the word back that they were plenty of wild game. So later on, some of the members of the tribe came down, and they settled down here on the bank of this Deepport River, and been all along that coming, and been there. After so long, where they started a village down here, in a little place they called Phallus.
No, it's over there.
Yeah. They started a village there.
Now, who started it? Do you remember the names of the family?
Well, yes. Their folks, our grandparents, didn't live right in the village with them, but they had a place to stay.
Mm-hmm.
But they were living just a little ways from this village. But they were such as my mother's
mm-hmm.
father and uncles. They were the other chief.
Tohi.
Yeah.
Is that the family?
Hallowell. And
mm-hmm.
Tohi. So then they all started that village down there and lived down there. And up till in the days of the Allotment Act come in,
mm-hmm.
then when that went over, of course they were notified that they had allotments. They had land mm-hmm. of so many acres apiece that they must go and live on. Well, then they did. The ones scattered out, still they were in the village, but they were out
mm-hmm.
trying to find a location where their mm-hmm. land or allotment.
How did your grandfathers feel about the Allotment Act? Were they against it?
In a way, he doesn't feel very good over that.
No.
He didn't feel that it should been such a thing as allotment.
Mm-hmm.
He feel that it should have been in reservation.
Yes.
And there. And of course in that line there's a few other things giving the reason why all that. This other way, the allotment, it is true. They only have so many acres that each one was allotted during that time.
Mm-hmm.
That leaves all the younger generation without a land, without a home.
That's true.
If it was in reservation, there they would go out and establish a home on a reservation wherever they wished to.
Mm-hmm.
They would have the privilege of taking a choice where they should establish their home. But still, the land would belong to the tribe.
To the tribe.
There, the generations to come would have a place to go and live and try to make a living and live.
Because no one could sell it.
No. Then, they're aware, as I often say, they're very good people wherever you go. Find good people, very instructive, and very peaceful people. The cattlemen, while it was in the reservation here, the cattlemen took over.
They just came right in?
Leased for grazing purpose, so they came from the tribe.
They did that?
Yes.
Before allotment?
Before the allotment.
Cattlemen came, and to whom did they talk?
They talked to the chiefs, and they made their dealing with the chiefs through the agent. Then the agreements were drawn up by and through the agent.
And who was that Indian agent? Do you remember his name?
Well, first I can remember back in those days, of course, now it's a fellow named, the old gentleman named Patrick.
Good Irish name.
Irish name.
What was he doing out here?
Yeah. And after he retired, and he was up in ages, so he was retired. Then his son took over.
He did.
Lee Patrick.
Do you remember him?
Yes, I remember. And after he retired, then there was several other gentlemen come in.
And some of them were good and some of them were bad, I imagine.
Yes.
Well, now, about Thomas, what else can we say about him?
Who?
Thomas.
Oh.
Remember, we want to put everything we can down about it.
Well, in that run there, well,
are there any stories about what he did on the hunt or the warpath or whatever?
No, he never was on the warpath or anything like that, but if he was, he'd be on himself.
You mean he wasn't fighting the Osages?
Well, you take that, as you mentioned about warpath, you know that it seems so that they were very peaceful people, and they were not no great hand to get on warpath or all that on there, but they will defend themselves.
Of course. I wonder if he ever was in a fight.
No.
Never?
No, he never was in a fight, anything like
that. Well, if he were born in 1820, the Iowas were having some trouble with some of their neighbors up there.
Yes, they had.
It seemed to me he would have been in some battle.
But it wasn't the whole tribe.
Did the Eagle Clan not participate?
Well, no, not, not as I think of, only just what his brother. But they might at that I don't know on there, but still they were supposed to be peaceful people on there.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them, especially the chief, every chief is supposed to be a peaceful man.
I see.
He doesn't participate in no kind of war.
Okay. Are there other people who do that?
Yes, there are other people who do that. And that's the reason you hear about chief so-and-so is a big warrior and scout and all that. And maybe they do, and I don't know. But first I know about the tribe, they don't. But they have warriors there. And that's a different group of people in the same tribe, you see.
Mm-hmm. What clan would tend to be warriors? What clan?
I
wonder.
Well, I'd better not say that right now. Maybe later on sometime that I will. But where's Grandpa, when they come into this country here, where they began to try to help themselves to make a living, like they all did back yonder, raising their food down here on the deep fork bottoms and all that, and they established home there. And all the way along, like they always have before, and raised different kinds. As main talking question is pumpkin and corn, you know.
Did they ever raise squash?
Yeah.
Squashes.
Yes, when they say pumpkin, they means all that.
All that family.
Yes.
Could be any. It's just not only the orange pumpkin.
When they say corn, well, it's like they're saying, well, they're different kinds. A color of corn, okay? But it's all corn.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the way they word it on me.
Was the chief, your grandfather, was he supposed to do work in the field? Or did the chief not do work?
Well, yes, he gets out. They all just gets out just to help. And other times, well, someone would come along, would offer a help from there. And that's the reason I'll say you find good people somewhere.
That's right.
I'm trying to show their respect to people, be kind to people and all that. Of course, that's the reason I'll say, well, you'll all find people like that on there. Yes, it's up to them whether they want to do something or whether they don't want to, or what. It's just up to them.
To the chief.
Yes. Now, that's the way it works in that line. But although they were looked to them for betterment of better condition, as we must say, educational purposes in Indian line.
I see.
You see, not in English, but you know, there's some pretty well educated Indians in their custom and they have those.
And the chief was to be well educated.
Yes.
What did he have to know?
Very instructive from there.
What did he have to know?
Well, they know of different things in such a way as a person would come home. Need advice would ask what would be the best and what not from me.
I see.
Then they'll study over and give him the very best advice that they can give him. And whether it's wrong or not, they explain the both sides of the story to him so they will understand that way from me.
What kind of problems or what kind of advice or what kind of a situation would a person bring to your grandfather? What would a person ask your grandfather about in those days? If he was going to give advice, what would it be about?
Well, and mostly, just like I say, it would be depends on just what a person would ask, what it would be in that.
Would it be about hunting, or would it be about a family problem?
Yes, that's just what I was going to say. It might be a family trouble, or certain a child or something like that, you know, and they make a study of that. Well, from I must say, from old to young, depends on the question that they're asking.
I see,
and then they naturally they bring out the very best words and instruct them how to live, how they should carry themselves as they go along. What I mean by go along is as they grow over. And by that, well, some of the people even take their children to people like that. They would say, their parents would say, I want my child to learn something that which it might benefit him, benefit to him or her. I would like for you to give a few words, or might say instructions, or telling about things. And then they they'd study it over and maybe set a date, certain time, something like come back. Then they'd set in there, go to teaching the children. And at the same time, not only this party, but also their parents must talk and learn the child.
Would he take a group of children? Would he take a group of
young people? No, maybe sometime one or two or three or sometime, yes, might take a group of children.
About what age?
Well, from, you might say, well, I'd say that when they're big enough to understand and begin to learn a little bit long, maybe 4 years old, maybe something like that, and then on up from maybe 6 years old.
Did all parents of the clan take their children into the chief?
Yes,
They did.
And then also they go to some other other chiefs that they help make sense with the prayer.
Did the chief give names?
Yes. Yes, they give names, but they don't take one clan's name and give it to a different one.
No,
they've got to take their own.
Their own clan.
Yes, their own clans are not.
Did one?
It's all that, you might say it's all divided up, they got to watch. I don't know. So in that way, well, it takes a person, as you say, giving name, they have to be authorized. I might say, at the present time, we notice that preacher got to be ordained before he became a preacher.
Yes.
Have that title.
That's true.
Same thing way. You got to have that title, be ordained, and be authorized to do these things. If not, everyone could go out and do that. If there is one, he's just a mocker and just deceiving people. That's where they explain that part with an Indian. It's wrong if they don't do that. Must go to the right party, and that's what they mean by he has the right and the tie and everything. Just like I'm saying, he's been ordained to these things in India.
Who taught you? Your father?
Well, my grandpa's.
They taught you the ritual to give names.
Yes. They. Well, in one way, of course, dad, he belonged to one clan, and mother belonged to one clan, another clan. So by that, well, I must say I put me on both sides of the whole thing,
And your mother's clan was the Buffalo clan?
Yeah, Buffalo.
Was that another leading clan?
Yes, that's one of the legal clan, and her mother was a bear.
A bear.
So then she was a buffalo and a bear, you see. So then there I am. Our dad here was eagle. So that
was he all? He couldn't be all eagle though.
No.
Because what was his mother? What was your father's mother?
Well, her father's mother, I would know that's too perfect.
Your father's mother.
Yes, and so on. So in a way, well, that's where it leads by that, and the general watch that which they do watch that. So in one way, when a person gives these names, he's just not just giving a name and just a talking. When you give a name, that name is forever. Even the person that carries a certain name, if he is a deceased or her deceased, that name will be mentioned after it's gone. They'll think of the deceased. That party is that name, this name, carry that name. That's nasty. We know and understand here today, when some people get up and talk, mention about good people, well, they mention his name. They know who they're talking about. Maybe he's been gone 100 years or something like that.
That long?
Yes.
Now, can you remember anybody that long ago?
Well, no, I would have to study him. Think of those things on that.
Well,
I do know,
these two people are almost 100 years ago. Your uncle and your grandfather Thomas, that's almost 100 years ago.
Yes,
1860,
yes,
when they went
yes.
to war. He went to war.
Yes, as I say, I do know, but I can't think of right off hand to those on hand.
What other things do you remember about Thomas? What did he look like? Did anybody ever describe him?
Well, no, I don't believe so, Ronnie, but the way I understand it, he was a slender man,
mm-hmm.
pretty well built.
Mm-hmm.
And straight and slender man, mm-hmm. weighing maybe around about 200 pounds, I'm pretty close to that.
My goodness.
Well, but he had the frame to carry that.
He was tall then.
Yeah, tall.
Mm-hmm.
And now, Dad, he was that way. He was a slender, tall. And he must have been around about 180 or something like that in his right prime when Dad was. But he was a straight built man. But anyway, that's where Grandpa was, I understand.
Mm-hmm.
Where he was building that farm. And then, so in that way, well, after so long coming into Oklahoma, settled down here, and they've been here ever since, although they'll go back up yonder and visit, you see.
Back and forth.
Yeah, back and forth. When they go back up there, they had a place to go up there.
Mm-hmm.
And then they had a place.
Mm-hmm.
So also, they had, a home up there, they can go to.
Are these two groups of Iowans still friendly or not?
Two groups of Iowans.
This one in Oklahoma and that one up north?
Yes.
Do they still visit or not?
Yes, they do, if there's any. Not.
Do you have any kinfolk up there?
Yes. I don't know whether they're up there or not, but they're
you
supposed
have
to be up there.
Kin?
No, they carry different names on there.
Uh-huh.
I have some kin folks up there. They call them Lightfoot.
Lightfoot?
Mm-hmm. And then there is, well, I can't think of that with them. So then there was another one there. They call him Norris.
Norris?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm, Norris. But I don't know where they're at. I don't know whether they're still up there or not. For some years I haven't been back up there to see what that country looked like now. But they have gone back and forth, like you're saying.
Yeah.
Like you're saying, they're wizards here.
Back and forth.
Yes.
What else did Thomas have to do as a chief besides talk to young people and give advice? What were some of his other responsibilities as chief when he was here? What other things did he have to do besides, you said he had to give advice, talk to people. What other things was he expected to do?
Well, that's just what I started. As I say, they began to work up a garden spot and things like that. They had to have that living room. That's one of the first things on there. And then they went along and trying to make a living, make their home like it should be, and also they got out and hunted, besides their garden and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And coming down to a tribal affairs, or some gatherings, they all come together and put on a big feast and put on a big dance. During them days, they were more particular about what they're doing on, even in their program.
Oh, yes.
Care on things more better than we do nowadays. But anyway, I'm not saying this to say anything out of the way, but what I mean by that, we don't care on like they did there. But anyway, they have
that they'd get together. I know there were times when they knew they should get together for a reason.
Hmm. Well, and sometimes, at times, I'd say this. Sometimes some family would put on a feast for their children or for themselves. I say something like birthday gatherings, and they all get together in such a way as that, or someone come to visit the tribe, or they hold
a
feast and get together to entertain the visitors.
Right.
It might be one or two, three visitors. Then they have other feasts in such a way as a going away, you see.
Going
now, supposing if they were going off on a trip, maybe they'll all visit other tribes, or just going out on just on a trip on it. They give that feast that they might go and return back safe, you see.
It was a religious feast then. Was it a religious feast?
Well, yes, it leads into that. Yes, it leads into all of that.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's something that they never do leave out.
Never.
No, they think of all of that. Now, as I say, going away feast, as I mentioned, I said, even on their return, after they get back, or after their relatives rejoice, happy to see them return back, and also they feel really happy to get back to see them, then they hold feast again.
Alright, that's the third type of feast.
Yes, and things like that.
How about the time of marriage?
Yes, they hold feast there.
Uh-huh.
That feast there during the marriage, the feast don't begin until when they couple get together, then they feast.
I see.
Now then, now there's something there that I haven't seen in that line for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of, as I have said in some speech and talks, the ending has kind of a peculiar ways when you don't understand it.
They're not peculiar.
Yeah. Now there, the boy might be over here going with a girl for some years and nobody won't know anything about it.
Well, how could they get away with that?
Well, I'll come to that. Now, and even their folks wouldn't know anything about their mother and father on both. I wouldn't know anything about it. Well, when time comes, of course, only one knows is him and her. And they'll come to an agreement. There's a day coming that they're going to get together.
Yeah.
Well, then when that time comes, they get together and go without anyone knowing.
Where do they go?
I don't know, just go somewhere and stay somewhere. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. On the land,
yes,
belonging to the tribe.
Yeah.
They stay on the tribe.
Away from her. Then the folks on both sides will begin to understand there must be something up.
Yeah.
Well, with fish, they go.
Something's up, it's right.
Yeah. Well, then, they go to investigating when they run off. They run, they must be here somewhere. Well, so long ago, somebody look from running to them, bring them back.
Oh.
You see, they bring them back.
After they had a baby or before? After they had a baby or before?
After.
After the baby was born.
Yeah. And then they've come back and the girl would go to her folks, and the boy would go to his folks.
Yeah.
Then his folks goes after the girl over there and bring her back over here.
Do they take any gifts?
Yeah, no, well, they'll come later.
I want the gifts to come.
Yeah, well.
Mr. Blaine Kent, Speaker.
Just when it was.
Mm-hmm.
But it's could say that it wasn't. Back in the early days.
Mm-hmm. Was your grandfather?
Yeah.
Your mother's father.
And then. Grandpa, well, he was hunting over there, northeast of Hickory, or southwest of Cushing, and about 5 miles northeast of Hickory.
Mm-hmm.
It's a big cannon lead for south. Well, he come in from up the cannon there, shot him down, slew there on the west bank of that gully. One day, he ride along all at once like his horse, hold his head up and look. He noticed that, well, Grandpa, he kind of turned in his saddle and looked to him. That is. So he sang, he stopped the horse, and they both look. There's something moving. Of course, in them days, you know, the wild grass, you know, when you can see, you know. Across the cannon there, where he's singing on the other side of the bank, there's weeds. Word on him, couldn't they come? Finally, he thought he'd turn his horse around and go down and tie his horse down there next to the tree down there in the cannon, walk on up to see what was. Of course, he had his Winchester, he was on a hunting trip anyhow, you know. Then he kept going up just about where he was. Yes, sure enough, I got up so close that he seen the slew grass and I'm moving him. So he walked up to that, and he seen a big hole there, and a coyote building a den there, hiding place or something. I don't know. He built a dugout, maybe. I don't
know. An highway dugout.
Yeah. But anyway, yeah. I stood there and watched. On a little dirt began to come out of that hole where he was digging. So on a little coyote's tail began to come out first and put us on a little dirt. Well, he seen it was a coyote. So then that he stood there, told that damn way, Kyle got his head out again and looked at that. Well, Rambo said, "Well, ho, where are you going?" He's talking Indian, talk Iowa in our own name. Coyote didn't say nothing, but he dropped and just shivering, shaking all over, and the old coyote never did say nothing. He just died right there, scared him to death from that. Yeah. Now, that's what my grandpa, Benjamin Hallwell,
said.
Yeah, that's the story.
Okay. Oh, fine. About what year was this?
It was about in 1883, mm-hmm. long yeah. fall of 83.
And what was he hunting?
He was hunting a deer or wild turkey or whatever he could find in that line, mm-hmm. such as wild hogs.
There were wild hogs here then?
Yes, there were like prairie chickens and mm-hmm. things like that.
And was he hunting on the Iowa reservation, was that?
No, he wasn't. He was on the Second Fox Reservation. Mm-hmm. Now, how come he was on the St. Fox Reservation? Mm-hmm. Because he was over the highway in St. Fox Reservation line.
Mm-hmm.
So he had to be in St. Fox, over the line, the St. Fox Reservation.
Yeah.
From Cimarron River through Ricklings down to the Deep Fork is a borderline of St. Fox and Iowa.
Yes.
West of that line is the Iowa reservation, and the east of that is the St. Fox reservation. So that's how come he was in St. Fox reservation. But although they all hunt, the St. Fox can come over on the Iowa reservation, hunt, camp out as long as they want to, and go back on their reservation. Also, the Iowas can do the same thing, go on their reservation and camp out and hunt and stay there as long as they want to. There's no one say anything about it. Furthermore, not only these two tribes, but the Kickapoos, Shawnees, and Potawatomis, all these tribes, adjoining tribes, the reservations, all that. There's nothing said about who could hunt or anything like that, but they all hunt like nothing.
How long did that last? How long were they able to do that?
Hey.
How long were they able to all hunt together on each other's lands? Until allotment came along?
Yes, until the allotment came along, and then it seemed so when the allotment act, when that took place, well, then it seemed like they just couldn't go here and there. Because when that allotment act come in, well, that means the reservation is going into something like a checkerboard.
Yes.
It was taken up by different ones, et cetera, and all that on there. So then they had to arrange some way or somehow where they can't cover the reservation like they did on account of other people coming in and filing claims. So by that, well, some people wouldn't allow to go on their place and hunt and all that,
so that was that time?
Yeah, that's where.
All that time.
Well, the other day, I met a fella that I had been known for some time, some year, and we were talking with him about some little things, finally they spoke. Got to talking about some of the old timers, I say some of the settlers or frontiers that came in here. Of course, he was a little boy then, but what he remembered, he was talking finally. We went into those questions as what become of some of these people that used to be here, live here in different places. And we were talking about different ones that we know, remember, even some of their children's old that. Well, as you were talking, I come to think
of a fellow that I met not too long ago. I said to this fellow, I says, do you remember the fellow that used to live over here on the bank of the river over here, in place known as Bert Wiley's farm? Mm-hmm. I said, you know where that place is?
Mm-hmm.
He said, yeah. He said, I know where that place is. I said, you remember Bert Wiley? He says, not hardly. He says, I was too young to remember him. But he says, I think I do. So then I said, do you remember who lived after Bert Wiley sold out and moved, who lived there and all that, or between any other family?
Yeah.
He said, no. Well, I said, I'm going to tell you. He said, the reason I'm asking you this question, I have to be over here to drum ride. And staying over there with my daughter and her family. And of course, I said, I'd jump in my car, just go out driving on, just to be riding on there. Regardless of what direction I went, but I just to be out riding on. I said, that's what I was doing that evening. I said, I went east of Drumride, about 7 miles out there, or something like that. I said, what made me go out there? I says, I thought of my father and mother, and also my grandparents, and some of the elder people in those days. Especially, I says, I thought about my father and mother. During that time, I said, I was just a little fella, but I remember something. I was old enough to remember, old enough to ride a horse. I went out then, I turned off, got off the highway, and I'm sitting there in a car, and thinking and studying. Well, what I was telling you about during that time, I said, I still had in mind of my folks that used to camp along that creek there, camp there, and also some of the other relatives. I said, my father, after they set up camp, everything settled down. My father always get on a pony, that which had belonged to me, the whole outfit. He'd get on that pony and take his Winchester, go down that creek, and where he'd go from there, I don't know. I said, he goes out on deer hunting, and he'd go out east from there, but I don't know where he goes. And everything else, man. Well, not only that time, or not only once, but every time we go out that way, I said, that's where we always camp. And that's in Creek Nation, they call it.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, that's which we call now our Creek Reservation. But anyway, there were plenty of wild games. That's how come we all go out there. And there was nothing said about Indians coming out there. It was free for all Indians to hunt, kill, hunt meat they want, or any kind of meat that they want that they could find. So then, I said that I was sitting there studying. Said to myself, this is where my folks used to camp. Dad used to go over there on the wild game. He'd bring in deer,
mm-hmm.
Another time he'd bring in maybe two or three wild turkeys. Then he'd come in and say, well, I killed a wild hog. I'll hang it up way out there on the trees. I'm going to have to go get it and come back for help. They'd hook the horses to a buggy and they'd go out there to haul a wild hog in. You know them wild hogs, when you look at them, why they're mean looking things. Just slender, you know.
Yeah.
But they're big.
How much would they weigh?
Some of them weigh around, now imagine around about 500 pounds like right there. They're big ones on that. And of course they have little ones, you know, and different sizes, but you take some of them big ones, they're the size of hog. But now, in the way, while I was sitting there, this fellow came along in a car and stopped. He asked if I was having car trouble or need help or anything like that, or something like that.
Yeah.
I told him, no, sir. I says, I'm having no kind of trouble, but sit here studying. Got to talk to him. He asked me where I was from.
Mm-hmm.
I told him, well, I says, I'm from the drum right here. My folks live in here. And I says, well, the was my home. I says, back here where I was born and raised. Southwest of Perkins, or southeast of Perkins, between Chime and Perkins.
Mm-hmm.
I said, on Headquarter Creek. I says, mm-hmm. Creek there.
Mm-hmm.
So we got to visiting. And he said, you know where the old Wilder place is? I said, yes. I said, which one of the Wilder? I said, you know, I said, speaking of Wiley, I said, yes. I said, there's Duck Wiley and Bert Wiley. Mm-hmm. I said, I know them. Yeah, and I'm speaking of Bert Wiley. He says, after he so long moved, it was after so long, he said, I live on that place for 2 or 3 years, he said. Well, I said, I know just where that place is, I know. So we got to Winston and told him. I said, I'm going to tell you the reason why I'm sitting here under this shade tree. I says, you see that big white sycamore tree standing over yonder? I said, he said, yeah. I said, right along the back of that creek there, I said. He said, yeah. I said, right there, I says, where my father and mother used to camp in the early days when I was a young boy. And my dad from there, I thought he covered a lot of this ground, how much he covered, I don't know, on a deer hunt, wild turkey. And I said, right across the road up here, by the road, on the north side of the road, the highway here. I said, there was a ranchman there. And the ranchman's name was Joe McGaw. That's one of the biggest ranchmen in the Creek Nation.
Yeah.
And Dad was pretty well acquainted with him, his friend. Mm-hmm. That's how come Mr. McGaw told him that he could camp down there and stay as long as he wanted and hunt as long as he wanted to.
Mm-hmm.
And Mr. McGall had, I could say how many hundred head of cattle he had over there.
Mm-hmm.
Over the range there. It was open range. But anyway, I said, that's how come we were there. They returned that, take a notion to go out hunting. Well, we start from home, come through the old city of Cushion.
Yes.
Get to plant a supply there, an ammunition, thing like that, and go out over in the Creek Nation and hunt us. I said, that's what I got in mind right now. I said, thinking about my father and mother and some of the elder people that would follow him over here, maybe 2 or 3 families that time. And I said, the rest of the men would scatter out where they go. I don't know. I said, they go out to wild game and they bring in what they could. They take care of the meat. Sure, we'll open fire and all that.
Oh.
Then, when they think they got plenty and enough supply of meat, then I said, they go back home, stay till they run out again, and then they go back. But anytime any of my people hear that my father's coming out here to hunt on the wild game, I said, there'd be one or two three, mm-hmm. four families were following him out here.
Mm-hmm.
I said, that's what I'm thinking about now. I said, thinking about back younger. I said, mm-hmm. I'm thinking about some my folks. That's where we used to camp down there. I said, that's what I'm out here. I said, now I said, when I leave here, I'm going back to where your drum right where my daughter's at. That's where I'm at right now. So this fellow said, well, he said, I live about 2 miles south here and bought a little piece of ground there and I rented additional land there. And later on, he said, I bought some more. So he said, I got a little place to live. But he said, I'm going out north here, he said, to see a fellow out there. So he left, and I don't know where he went, but he told me he's going north. He kept on going north, and I stayed there for quite a while. Then I turned around and come back to the drum line.
Fine.
Hello.
Who were some of the families that went with your father?
Hi.
Who were some of the families that went with your family? What were the names of them? Do you remember?
One was a grandpa, Benjamin Hollowell.
He went to?
And his sister and brother-in-law, Charles Tohee. And also his older sister, Maggie Lincoln. And also there were other family, an old gentleman named by John Moses. And another family, him and his wife, I don't remember his wife's name, but I remember her, but fuller name by Joe Dupuy.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, he was a younger man than
yeah.
my dad was. And then there was another, told me that time, a young couple, as I call her, David Toby.
David.
There is another older gentleman. Also, he was named David Toby. So how come they both carry the same name? Well, this older gentleman, the younger gentleman was his nephew.
His nephew.
David Toy and both carried the same name. That's the way that name.
Who was the chief then?
Huh?
Who was the chief then?
The chief?
Was there a chief?
Yeah, well, during that time, Dan told him, and my grandpa, Benjamin Hollowell, and then this elder, David told him, they were the chief of the family. And then, during that time on there, so by that time, before that time, well, my father's dad, I can't think of Thomas Nainoy. Then, but he passed away. Then, Dad, as they say, according to our tribe, that he should be the one after his father died, but for the longest time, he didn't occupy that place at all until after he thought it was time that he made himself known that he would, and then told the rest of the chief that he would not.
Yeah.
that's where you that went on there.
Ben Hollowell's name? Yes, I think. We don't have his Indian name. We don't have his Indian name. Though.
Well, I, you know, thought there had in mind that we might have talked on the how I was built their homes or their houses that they live in back yonder.
Okay. Today we're going to talk about number 7, which is on this outline, shelter forms, clothing types, and food types of the Iowa. Now, at what time in history are we going to be discussing? When they came to Oklahoma?
Yes, far as I can remember, or the story, the history that I heard from the before they come in Oklahoma.
All right.
And that far as I can remember, I might say, is some years back before my time, even after they did come in Oklahoma. But the shelters that they live in, that's what we call home. They had several different types that they have built so that they could live in. And I notice here, first I can remember, we had, that is the eyewitness, had what they call a grass hut. And they take a grass grows like a Johnson grass. They call it slough grass. It's not Johnson grass. It looks like Johnson grass, but it's not. They call it slough grass.
Slough?
And it grows up pretty tall.
Where does it grow?
Well, they go and out and gather in a lot of it, and they make that grass hut, and they fix it up like they're fixing a wigwam, by saying sticks, you know.
Sticks.
Yes. Uh-huh. So they bundle this grass and set them around all the way around, and then tie them up with a pole around it, so that they'll hold. Get up to the top where they'll have an opening up there, might say, for the smoke to go out, a smokestack, you might call them. Well, they had that kind of house. And the Indians, the Iowans, call it grass house. Mm-hmm. Then there was another shelter that they built, another home. It was built about like that. They built it. They got poles, just like I say, and small poles, and built a wigwam shape like they had built. You saying like
the one at your house?
Yes.
It's like an oval.
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of an oval shape.
Yeah. Well, then they used bark on that.
Bark.
Mm-hmm.
What kind?
Well, elm bark.
Elm?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They go out and select the trees, and they get to find the biggest trees that they can find. Mm-hmm. And they'll cut so high, I might say maybe 6 feet, maybe 7 feet high.
Yes.
And they'll peel that bark off.
Right off a tree? A live tree?
A live tree, you see. And then they take this, of course,
take a live tree like that, the green, the bark is green, you see.
Yeah.
So they can handle it just any way they want to. They lay that out on the ground, the bark, and then get where it'll cure out. Just like it would shingle or any lumber. Then they take it and set them up. Then they take long poles outside that, and then they tie them in crossways here and there.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't use no bale wires or string or anything like that. And then they take the same kind of tree, they peel the second bark off the alum tree, then use that for string.
The inner bark. They used it for string. How did they make it?
Well, they'll peel that second bark off of that limb, a small limb.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you'll find a limb, I might say 4 or 5 feet long, and you take a whole string of that.
Well, you run it this way, the length of them.
Then they'll, while it's green, well, then they take that and straighten that out. And when they get ready to use it, they'll soak it in water.
Uh-huh.
You see, then it limbers a rope or some string and all the twine string.
Mm-hmm.
So then they wrap that around and use that for string.
Around the joints of the two?
Yeah, either way.
Crossing?
Yeah, you can cross your poles or either way you want to, then use that tile. And now last a long time. It'll last a long time.
How long?
Well, you know, maybe about 30 years, maybe.
That long?
Mm-hmm.
My heavens.
They didn't use it. A lot of people wonder how they tie the pole together and wonder where they get their string and bailing wire and all that, but they had a way of finding things like that on there. And a lot of people don't know that, and they are no. And they even take them and they make her in the form of a rope. They braid them.
Hmm.
And make them about 30 feet long, maybe 40 feet long. And they use them for maybe, I might say, clothesline or something.
Would they ever use that for a horse bridle?
Yes, they use that, but not. But then they use that for many purposes after it's made in the rope line.
Mm-hmm.
They even cure the meat on that.
Let's see if we can list all the purposes you remember.
Okay.
Let's see if we can remember all the purposes that was used for. You said it was used for tying the poles together, for hanging meat on to cure.
Yes.
Well, that's two. Mm-hmm. Now what other, what else could you use it for?
And then, our clothesline.
A clothesline.
For clothes, thing like that. Where they, even their blankets or something.
Yeah.
Whatever they want to hang
on.
Whatever they hang on there.
Okay.
So they use it for that. But now they may, that's what they call the shelter is talking about is bark house.
Bark house.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, how did you decide what size to make it?
Well, they go according to the steps, and they call it I think the way they call it now, a yard, I think, but then it's just about a yard.
They step it off.
They step it off, you see, they step it off. By that, they'll step off maybe about 6 steps wide, maybe 4 steps wide, depending on it. And then different length, so many steps.
Mm-hmm.
Then they'll get enough pole, they'll set the poles maybe about 4 feet apart.
4 feet.
Mm-hmm. Then they'll bend them over.
At the top.
Mm-hmm. Then they'll have another string of pole again, crossways on it, like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then lay there. Bark or
mm-hmm.
on that. then on top of that, after they set the bark around it, well, then they take another string of poles again.
Oh, there's two sets of poles, inner and outer set.
Yeah. So that way, well, that'll hold the bark, huh?
Yes.
You see?
Uh-huh.
And they'll use the bark for the root, sides, and all, and water doesn't go through there and never leave.
Did you ever live in one?
Oh, yes.
Did
I've
you?
Yes, I've been in around there. So, in a way, they pick out a place where they should build this. And then they come choice about where they're building, how they're going to build, and all that.
Mm-hmm.
They study the way out on it. So there's another.
Where would they build one? By a stream? Where do they build them?
Well, they'll find a location. It would say kind of a knoll like.
A hill, small hill.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And then. Of course, they might be a pretty good size knoll, all that. The reason on that, see, whenever it rains or rainfall, the water will run off here and hold this knoll dry, you see. By that, well, then they'll clean the spot, the barren ground, and the water's actually pretty clean the whole time.
Around the knoll?
Yeah, around the knoll. So there, well, have them muddy place.
Not like here.
Yeah.
They're doing better in those days than they are now, aren't they? Oh dear.
So.
Well, how many? Go ahead. Did they build these close together in a village?
Yes. Yes, they're not too close together. Well, when they're in the village, well, they'll. Oh, I might say, maybe. About 15, 20 feet apart, some of further than that.
Mm-hmm.
That when they're in the village, well, they build them like they would street like.
A street?
One row beyond here, one row in back, like that one there, all the way around. Or it could be one row and just going on out, maybe two rows.
In a circle?
And then they're, like I say, maybe 20 feet, maybe 30 feet apart, you see.
I see.
Now, some of them put well quite a ways off.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let's suppose that, let me draw the plan of a village now. Which way would the streets go? Did they go north and south, or was there any direction?
Well, it depends on as I say, the street, I don't really mean the street, but they're all in a row just like that. But they could be in a circle.
They could be in a circle.
Which they do in a circle.
Like this?
Yes. Like that.
What was the center used for? Was that the area where the dancing was done?
Well, yes. 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 They would be a.
Do you want
to? They would be a. Of course, there'll be a gathering place, you see, around there.
Would that be right?
Mm-hmm.
Would this be a typical?
Yes. Well, in a way, it might be that mm-hmm. there would be.
Mm-hmm.
This would be all opening here. Mm-hmm. And there'd be opening here. And there'd be another road back here. Maybe.
You mean there wouldn't be any houses here?
Yeah.
There would be none?
No.
Okay, we'd cross them off then.
Mm-hmm.
Would they be behind each other or in between?
Yes, and well, it doesn't make no difference where they set them.
Okay.
So
now these are the bark houses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now this is open.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Well, that's for to come in just like.
Yeah. You gotta get home.
Doorway, hallway.
Would this village face toward the east?
Yes.
Okay, mm-hmm. This would be east then.
Yeah.
Now
then, otherwise again,
okay.
Now there's another way
mm-hmm.
that they could run this way and then run on that way just in a square shape.
Mm-hmm. And it could be a square, all right.
Yes.
And I'll make one here. This would be the, let's say this would be the first type of village in a semicircle.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then the second type would be a square, like this.
Mm-hmm.
About how many houses would be in a village? How many of these would be in a village?
Well, I don't know. There'd be just as, there'd be quite a few. And then there's a, depend on how big the tribe is, you know, and there they can be.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, maybe we can talk about the size of villages and who lived where after we finish the types of houses. You know, we're talking about the bark house now, aren't we? Well, rather than go into village organization as to who, I mean, maybe this clan would live here, maybe another clan would live here. We better not get into that right now. We better wait until we finish discussing the types of houses.
Yeah, because
that's going to be real complicated when we begin to talk about that.
Now then, they also have these grass house and bark house, like we were talking about.
Grass house.
They'll only gather out, just like you say, and of course it won't be, but there'll be a kind of a driveway, as we said, you know, between.
A driveway.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
So now then, they also live in teepees.
Teepees.
And also they live in what they call mud house, the way the Indian, the way the Irish live there, I'd say.
Mud?
This is Irish, I can't say an Indian.
All right. No. Mud house. Okay, that's a good house.
Yeah. Well,
I... Want to talk about teepee first?
Yes, they...
How do you make one?
Well,
let's make a teepee.
Well,
nobody
anyway,
can hear that but us.
Yeah.
Nobody can hear that but us.
Anyway, they go out and select poles.
Same time.
Long poles, maybe about, I'd say maybe about 4 inches down to the bottom and then on up. And about 10 or 12 feet long for a teepee. Then they have a 16 poles of those. And then there's two more, makes 18. So, these 16 that sit around, they tie 4 of them together with that buffalo hide, or nowadays we use ropes and things like that. Well, they tie them together, then after they tie them together, they hoist these 4 poles up, set them, spread them out. Then they go to land these other 12 poles around.
How far apart?
Well, it depends on the size of the tent, I might say. Sometimes they're about 3 or 4 feet apart. Doing back some years back, they used buffalo hides and deer hides. But nowadays we use canvas.
Too bad.
Too bad. Well.
When did you start using canvas? About 1880?
Yes.
So the buffalo disappeared.
Yes. They were few, but not very many, but they're all gone now. But yes, about along in 18, yes, about along in there, I guess, when they had somewhere in the 80s, when they had 18.
Did you live in a teepee? Did you live in a teepee?
Sure.
Did you live in a grass house?
No.
Never got to live in a
grass house? Well, I've been in them, but then, I have to stay in them, but whereas I lived in that bark house and teepee, been in those more than I did. So in a way, well, talking about teepee now. All right, as we do now, we use canvas, as I said, while I'm going on there.
Mm-hmm.
Them days it's a buffalo hide and deer hide. But they do sew these canvas together, just I like the way they done. And then they put them up, and after they get them up, well then these other two pole comes in then. They have a kind of a wing sets out there.
In the front?
On top in the front. Then they use them, as I said, damper. It depends on how, what direction the wind blows.
Oh,
from.
I see.
They'll move those cheap poles that hold these wings up, see up there. So then they use them so the smoke won't stay in there. Smoke goes out. And for dampers, it's a front water, you want to have.
Yeah.
And, so that's what these two other poles were.
I was wondering what they were for.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, in that way, well, myself, well, there's some people try to say nowadays that they try to say, well, trying to talk like they began to build teepees right. It's like a few years, but no, they've been building teepees, living teepees and all that, right? So that's the way they put up their teepees, and then they have a rope on the outside for stake where all these poles tied together there. They tie this rope up there, then they stake it out. So that's the whole of the teepee down, you see. So the wind will blow it over.
Does the rope come down like this, or does it go over and fasten to something else?
It just comes straight down from them. Just like that, and just
it's real tight then.
Yeah.
Is it pegged in the ground? Pegged in the ground?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Sets off quite a ways, maybe.
How far?
Maybe about 10 feet away from the teepee.
Okay.
They reach up there to the peak of the teepee. Well, that's where they built them teepees and live in them. And then the mud house, now that's kind of a funny way. They have about 4 feet of wall and they bring them up. And that's a lot of work to that. It takes several poles, forks. Not a lot of oil. And then they take the sod and lay it up there all the way around.
How big was it?
Oh, they're building different sizes from there.
How big was the biggest one, Dave?
Well, you take a big one, that's where they might hold a gatherings. That is tribal gathering where they bring the size from there. Maybe about 150 feet round.
Around?
Mm-hmm.
Were they round or were they oval?
Round.
They were round, like a circle.
Yes,
okay.
And then they have a little hallway in front.
How long is that?
Now from this main entrance, it's had a little door in that hallway.
What kind of door?
Well, just an opening door there.
Well, it wasn't a wooden door. It was just a doorway. Doorway.
So then, right at the main part on the inside there, there's another door. Put blankets or hide or something.
Buffalo.
And in the center of it, build fire, and that's where they do all the cooking and all that.
Could have a fire hole. Yeah. Could have a hole for the smoke to go out.
Yeah, up there. Smoke will come on up there. To the top and everything. Hole up there.
They have any big center supports, wooden supports? You know, those big wooden logs? They have any of those inside, from the roof to the floor?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
How many? Do you remember?
Yes. Mm-hmm. They have
them. I meant this, you know, this kind of a support inside, wooden. You know, see, this is the lodge. Did it have any wooden poles inside the roof?
Yes, that's what I was talking about. Take a lot of them forks, you know, and they use forks, and then they forks. And they lay poles on the forks. So when they build them to that, to this 3 feet, as I said, 3 or 4 feet high, another pole is rest on each here.
Yeah.
Pole here. And then there's another pole reaches from there on up here. Then they support that again, you see, smaller poles. Then they cover all of that with the dirt. Even that will fall in.
All dirt. Was it sunk in the ground?
Yes.
How far down in the ground did
you say? About 3 or 4 feet.
How'd they dig the hole?
Huh?
How did they dig the hole? What they used to dig with?
Well, I don't know. They dig with a... Well, now it's handy. They use a spade and shovel and you see on there.
How long did they have... What did they use before they had spades and shovels to dig the hole?
Well,
it's a shoulder bone, the buffalo?
And then there's another wood. They sharpen that. And then they of course, they flatten it all and sharpen it. They use that.
What did that look like?
It looked like a spade out there.
You draw pictures. You don't have to be an artist.
Well, the way they take a... Well, I'll draw it first. I'm so nervous.
What are you nervous for?
Oh, in the world. Well, anyway, we said this is the hand.
What was the Iowa word for the grass house? What was the Iowa word?
Hachichi.
Say it twice.
Hachichi.
Okay. The bark house.
Nohechi.
Say it again.
Nohechi.
Okay.
Like a teepee. Chibo thracha. Chibo thracha. Then there's the other one, there's a money kitchen.
The mud house.
Money kitchen.
The word for house is kitchen then.
That's what we talk about now, honey.
Okay, now we're talking about the mud house. Now,
well, that's where that can go on then, okay?
Fine.
And then. And they also live in dugouts and in log houses.
That's another type then. Dugouts. What's the difference between a dugout and a mud house?
Well, the dugout, they go out here and they'll find a location. It'll be a bank. And they dig back in a bank, bank here.
Mm-hmm.
And then they go digging so far back in there.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll get two poles, one here, maybe three poles. They're long, these poles here, forks, you see, big poles.
Forks. Mm-hmm.
And they lay a log up there, and they'll split rails, then go ahead and lay it on top.
Inside to hold up the dirt.
So then they'll go in, they leave there, put grass on, like a slough grass or something like that, and they shove dirt on that. Then they have the dugout. They fix them.
How big would it be inside?
Maybe about 9 by 10, 9 by 12, something like that. Okay. So they live in those kind of houses.
What's the word for that?
Mahachi.
Mahachi. Is that the same word as this?
No, money kitchen.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Money kitchen and mahachi.
For dugout.
It's a little different in there, isn't it?
Yeah, I can hear.
So, log house. As they come along, you see from there, coming down. Well, then they began to build log houses. Instead of having to go out and get logs, dig out cottonwood tree,
cottonwood
oak trees, like that on there, they began to build log houses.
Where'd they get the idea for that?
Well, in Waywell, I don't know, they call him a summer quarters on there, you must say. And at that, where they did have a double log house, and then between the two log houses, there'd be a long opening there. And then, so in summertime, well, they'll have two rooms, you might say, to live in, and then have a
place in
the room. Yeah. Place to sit down between the two rooms on there in the summer. But at that, you can live in a room during wintertime. That's just warm.
Did you ever live in one?
Yeah.
What do you call that in Iowa?
Them long houses? She nunket. Naked tantawa. She nunket. Naked tantawa.
Word to say, isn't it? Do it one more time.
Huh?
Say it once more. I want to hear.
She made she talked to her.
Okay. Would you say this log house that they got the idea from the early white pioneers, or is this an older idea?
No, I believe. Well, yes, I kind of think they did got some idea of
white
more modern ways, and as we come along from there.
but nowadays, at the present time, later on, began to live in these frame houses.
Frame houses.
Yeah.
And what did they call them? What did they call them? The Iowa word for frame house.
Frame house, right. Chino bracca.
Okay.
No bracca.
Chino bracca.
Now, where's the?
Are you getting tired? You want to stop for a while?
Good.
Okay, let's rest because we've been talking now almost 40 minutes.
Okay.
I think we rest. This is June the 24th, and Mr. Kent wants to say a few more things about house or shelter forms before we go into the discussion of clothing. Okay.
Well, there were another shelter, I'd say, or home. It was called the same as the mud house, only this house was built square.
Mm-hmm.
And just like I say, well, that step loft,
mm-hmm.
I would say about 7 or 8 steps across,
mm-hmm.
and then about, I say, from 8 to 12 steps back.
Mm-hmm.
And by that it'd be in a square, the floor, the whole thing wall and all.
Yes.
And then they got a pitch to it, just like roof on the house now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then they cover all of that with a mud, dirt,
mm-hmm.
what it would be mud called on there.
Yeah.
Sod on there. Then they have a door there and have a little opening there just like a window on there, where they get the air and breathe on there. They can set them anywhere they want to on there.
Mm-hmm.
And then they also, the wigwam, it's built around, or you can build it any way you want to, but mostly they build the ends around. Lengthways like that, long ways in their ends. They call them wigwam, as I would say. Then the way I understand, way back in the early days, they used the same material as a deer hide and buffalo hide to cover that with.
Mm-hmm.
But nowadays, coming back to the cotton again, well, we use canvas in there.
Okay.
And we still use canvas yet, and I guess if you ever tan any of the Indian gatherings, you'll see some of those.
Yes, uh-huh.
And then, so they did live in them, and all these houses was built so that they can live in, kept up just like any other building.
Mm-hmm.
And they keep up in good repairs and all that. Of course, that's the only kind of house they had during that time. And we still do yet try to build these homes yet. And you see quite a few of them,
mm-hmm.
a few of the teepees yet from there.
Mm-hmm.
But it's been a long time since I've seen any of these mud houses from there.
Yeah.
That's something. It comes in pretty handy during winter days when it's cold.
They were very warm, weren't they?
Yes,
they were really
warm.
Mm-hmm.
And then they fix a place, a fireplace in these homes where you can lay a log in there, maybe it might say 4 feet or 5 feet long.
Hmm.
Lay them in there.
Mm-hmm.
That is during the winter time.
Yes.
And then during the summertime where they don't build quite as big fires as they would in the winter time, But they do cook in there and all that on there. And they have plenty of room to live in and all that on there. So that in a way, well, of course, it's all dirt floor, you must say.
Yes, uh-huh.
But still, it was kept very level, and they bring that dirt up inside by mixing with ashes, certain kind of wood. They take that mixing and smear it all over in there. Then after that gets dry, it gets dry as pretty near hard as this concrete, must say. Cement.
Mm-hmm.
Now I don't know whether anyone know how to mix that. There's a certain kind of tree that they use.
What is it?
It's a hickory.
A hickory? Uh-huh. Ash.
Uh-huh. Ash. And then a bur oak, they call it, I think, or an oak tree on there.
What
tree.
Kind of oak?
Bur oak, they call it.
Hmm.
And they burn all that wood into ashes,
mm-hmm.
so that they use it just like wood with cement nowadays on there.
What kind of mud?
They go out here and get the some of this black clay or
it's
red
a clay.
Clay.
Uh-huh. It's a clay. Always uh-huh. a clay.
Yes. Uh
huh.
Then they dampen that just like mm-hmm. and use water, mm-hmm. you know, and dampen it, keep mixing it up around there. And they go to laying it in and smooth it off from it. And so then you don't see no loose dirt.
No.
At all.
No.
It's all on that.
Did you ever make any?
Huh?
Did you ever make any?
No, I never. Well, I have little, yes. Mm-hmm. And I made some during the time Dad built a dugout on there in order to lay it in there between the logs on there.
Oh, you used it for that too?
Oh, and used it for that too mm-hmm. on there. And then you can use it for floor too.
Where was that dugout? Was that out by where?
Yes, it's out there. Where you know where folks is at. Home
yeah.
at. Right down next to the creek down
mm-hmm.
open there.
Mm-hmm.
That's where he built, I don't know, 3-4 dugouts on there.
I
different
see.
Places
uh-huh.
on there. And so that's where they got long. And they have a little choice about where they build the houses. And then another thing that they make a door, all the doors, facing east.
Why?
Why?
Now we get into
all
something
right.
else, don't we?
Yes. Now, that question has been asked many times, why, even Indian among themselves that don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, you can see them. They just put up anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Just thin. But you notice the wind blows from the south, southwest, or west, or northwest.
Mm-hmm.
Or the north wind blows.
Yeah.
Or any of these, what they call a storm or tornadoes, or whatever you call them on name. I think that's what they call them anyhow. Well, they all come. One come from southwest, and the other one from northwest.
Yes.
On there. And cyclone and tornado.
Mm-hmm.
Tornado come from this way around, I think. From there. And the cyclone come from this other way around.
Yes.
All right. There, they don't face all this wind.
No.
Or the cold breeze no. that blows. And then are the
mm-hmm.
hot weather, hot wind. When you're facing the east, well, that blows over, don't blow in the house.
Is that the only reason?
That's the reason.
Okay.
And then, furthermore, the addition to that, there's a little sacred ceremony to that, you see.
Something to do with the sun, perhaps?
Huh?
Something to do with the sun coming up in the morning.
Yes.
Yes,
uh-huh.
I
yes,
suspect uh-huh. that's
yes,
true.
Yes, well, I'll not go...
that's a different topic. We'll
uh-huh.
wait for that.
Yes, uh-huh.
Okay.
So now... And about the clothing.
Yes, sir.
I understand the story before my time
mm-hmm.
that there is the same material, I might say, as a buffalo hide and
mm-hmm.
And deer hides, mostly the deer hides.
Mm-hmm. Any other animals?
They use that. Mm-hmm. That's back in early days on there. Mm-hmm. They use all that. They tan that. They take care of it and tan it on there. And they tan them. Well, it'd just be as soft as any material that you'd see now.
Mm-hmm. How do they tan?
But I don't know how they do that. Of course, myself, I don't know how.
Did your mother ever do it?
Yes, she did. And some of the other elder ladies did know and all that. I don't know whether there's anyone living now or not that kin. Mm-hmm. And it might be, such as I would say, there might be some other tribe somewhere. Mm-hmm. Somebody.
I think the Cheyenne can do it.
Yeah, maybe Kickapoo's done. I think there's some down here, Kickapoo's might,
can
and Sagging Fox. Mm-hmm. But anyway, that's how they get their clothes. Okay. And later on, up till now, well, after so long, well, they began to get this cotton goods on there, and also wool and silk.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't plentiful, but still they got along all right with all that material.
Mm-hmm.
One thing is about the transportation shipments, freight, they had to do all the freight in wagons and things like that. It takes a long time to get a shipment in. But anyway, they began to use cotton, all that, and different silk.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, there's all in different colors, all right, on there. Where's that? Well, how come they began to get that on there? Well, they began to get that after the white man began to come in on there. Some of their older settlers and frontiers, they went to the Indians and asked them, see if they would run a store and try to bring in enough supply for their needs, whatever it is, man, the clothes, like we say, and food and stuff like that, and whatever. It might be ammunition or some tools to work with. So then the Indians agreed to it, but as I would say, this Indian trader had to go to the Indian office, talk to the agent, consult that, and get a special permit before they can, what they call Indian trading post on there. And the man that operates the place, they call him Indian trader. So then, after he gets that permit, he starts out with his business and whatever he can get in.
What did the Indians trade? What did the Indians use for trading the earliest time?
Well, sometime during that time where the Indians are great hunters and all that, sometimes they go out and get hides, and they trade that away or in cash. If they haven't got the cash right now, well, they still can get what they want through what income they had from the agent on there.
Oh, I see.
And in that way, when the Indian go out hunting and bring in a hide, well, this trader sends it off somewhere, I don't know, in St. Louis or somewhere.
Yes,
On the end. So then they use it for some, maybe shoes or something like that. I don't know what they use it for, but then
you
have a place to
sell it,
to market all that. But anyway, at the meantime, you might say, all this material and all of that, and the goods that they had, take a whole family when you have to use same kind of material. That is a man's clothes and women's and children's clothes, all that. So anyway, as they went along, this trader would bring in more stuff on there, new stuff on there. some different stuff on there.
Did they sew their own clothes?
How's that?
Did they sew their own clothes, or did they buy clothes already made when they came?
Well, no, they, there's a very little was already made that was the bought on there, but most of it was made by them on there.
Yes.
They still, now shoes, they were ready-made shoes shipped in, but they still was making moccasin. They wore mostly moccasin until now, and I guess I say, and they wear shoes all. So with dress goods or waist or also the children's dresses on there, it was that way. Also the man's on there. And the one great thing was the blankets. They all liked to wear blankets, the women and men, you know.
What were they like? What were the earliest blankets like?
Oh yes, they were, and they were very good blankets and a different weight, lightweight, medium weight, and heavy weight, so they're in different kind. And of course, they claim that they're 100% wool, and I believe there is 100% wool yet on their blankets.
Yes, I think so.
Yes. And then also silk shawls, that's for their girls and ladies and all that on there. And they're very nice looking shawls, 100% silk and all that, and then some of them wool on there. So today, well, we notice, well, there's quite a few of them on there.
Yes, all the round dances, the women wear their shawls with the fringes.
Yes.
When did the men stop wearing blankets?
Well,
did you ever wear a blanket?
Yes.
How old were you when you stopped?
Well, I don't remember just how old I was when I stopped. Otherwise, I didn't really stop wearing blanket. I still wear a blanket every now and then, but not like I did back yonder on there. And at that, I didn't wear a blanket like some of the old folks did wear a blanket all the time, every day, you know, on there. But I don't remember just how long ago it was since I was going to check more, so might say stop wearing blankets on there, but then still I...
What color was it?
Yes, right there. But anyway, there were some of the old people, and which there's not very many of them now that wear blankets.
Mm-hmm.
But they will wear blankets every now and then.
Who?
Some of the older Indians on there.
Iowa's?
Yes, Iowa's on there. And then also, I notice the other tribe, few of them still, very few of them on there. And mostly now the women wear.
Yeah, that's it. The women wear them at dances only. At dances only.
Yeah, and also the young women and girls they still wear a blanket yet. And
the peyote men wear blankets, so don't they?
Oh yes, I wore. Wore out half a dozen of them kind of blankets they wear.
Why were they always blue and red?
Oh, I don't know. That's just makeup.
They're always own, blue and red.
And then they're trying to say that they're the only ones to wear those blankets, but I've done worn whether I eat that thing or not. Not worn. I will wear one yet on them. I don't know. Nowadays, well, we wear all together, you might say, a civilian clothes, already made and all that on there. But once in a while, you'd see, especially when you go to these Indian gatherings, see Indian make, all that on there.
How many pieces of Indian clothing do you own? How many articles of Indian clothing do you own? Remember yesterday you were telling me that you still had your head dress.
Yeah.
You have that?
Yes, you mean the Iowa?
Yeah.
Yes, they had
the
that.
Iowa head
dress. Yes, they had that, they call them a head dress, on there. And then a war bonnet.
And then they have that, and then sometimes they don't wear them at all. Sometimes they just wear one feather on their head.
One eagle feather.
One eagle mm-hmm. feather, yeah.
What did the war bonnet look like?
Well, the war bonnet...
The Iowa.
Well, it's made like a bonnet, but all the feathers around from your forehead back, and this is over your shoulder on down, and,
mm-hmm.
and some of them just made just reach down over your shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
And then every now and then you see one made reach plumb down to the mm-hmm. ground. You might see around there.
What did you?
But this mostly is it's just these short ones on mm-hmm. there, just reach to your mm-hmm. shoulder on there. And them's all eagle feathers, supposed to be mm-hmm. eagle feathers mm-hmm. on there, and on there, and which they are on there. Of course, they put designs on them, such as beadwork, you know.
Oh,
the headband, mm-hmm, it's called, mm-hmm. run there. Put all that run there, and they decorate them feathers run there. Just, well, I don't know, there's certain colors, different colors. And
what color would you have?
Well, I would know, but I always like the white color.
Mm-hmm.
And also yellow.
Yellow.
From there, huh?
Did yeah. you ever wear a yellow?
Yeah, yeah mm-hmm. light color. But I have worn different colors on there.
Mm-hmm.
But I always think that these two colors are very pretty.
They
right
are.
There.
Yes.
What I mean is, it just shows up
mm-hmm.
good on there. That's really nice. That was my choice mm-hmm. on there. And but it takes about 2 eagles, and usually, yes, the tail feathers, as they call them.
No,
is
the ahu wing feathers?
Yeah, yes, well, they use some of them around mm-hmm. there. But you take their wings, they'll use them, the tip of the wings, for fan.
Oh, yeah.
You see
you
the
carry
head,
in your
huh?
hand.
And then they can take, as I say, well, go the tail feathers. They also can be used. You can fix them up, mm-hmm. decorate them up mm-hmm. as a fan too, mm-hmm. on there. And then the fans like that, well, they decorate them again. Mm-hmm. They put a fine, pretty beadwork on them, or whatever they want them. Put on there, you know, and decorate them right there.
Do you still have yours?
Yes, yes.
Fine.
Uh-huh. And moccasins, I wish they make their own moccasins, all that. They have designs.
What kind of designs do the Iowa's use?
More of a flower.
A flower?
Mm-hmm, yes, yes, mm-hmm. or a leaf, or mm-hmm. the flower design on this. But
mm-hmm.
and there, but the other designs I wouldn't know, because I notice quite a few other mm-hmm. designs and different
that have
kinds
come in from
yeah,
the outside,
made by different tribes, you know, around there.
Do you have any ribbon work?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Did your mother make it?
Yes.
Do you still have some?
Yes.
Good.
Mm-hmm, yes, I still have some. And I think my sisters, they have, well, I think they have the patterns too, Ronnie, yet.
Mm-hmm. Good,
Yeah. Now, they learn to make mm-hmm. ribbon work, thing mm-hmm. like that, Ronnie.
I wonder if they could show me.
I guess so, mm-hmm. yes. Guess
I'd like to learn how to do that.
Yeah. Yes, it's quite a interesting, and to make those things, and as you make them, you can learn,
mm-hmm.
get more idea of how mm-hmm. you want to fix them all.
That. I would very much like to have a ribbon work blanket, because
yeah.
I've seen some of the women wearing them.
Yes. Well, you notice, yes, they wear them.
Beautiful things.
Yes, and then some of them, as they call them skirts, you know,
yes,
they wear them out.
The Iowa women wear them.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes, they have them around there. And the men's, well, they wear leggings the same way, and they have ribbon works on them. So they, on their shirt, well, as I said a while ago, Indian shirt, well, they have ribbon works on them.
Really? Are there any of those shirts around?
Yes.
Are there some shirts around?
Yes.
I've never seen any ribbon work on shirts.
Yes, and they have ribbon work around the cuff here.
Mm-hmm.
And then sometime they string them up and down, and then sometime around. Mm-hmm. And then sometime around the collar here, or the
seam. Oh, around here. The seam.
Mm-hmm. Yes, around there. And then they have ribbons, different color, wear any color that you wish to put on, I guess, on there. Mm-hmm. Color that you like, or something, with your choice on there.
Okay.
And then they wear these, I'd say, pretty handkerchief, wrap around their neck on there. They wear them around there. Some of them they wear bead works.
Mm-hmm.
And then some elk teeth or something like that, you know, on there.
Elk teeth?
Uh-huh. I don't know whether there's
any of those.
I'm just wondering whether there is any elk teeth or not. They
haven't seen any.
Yes, they weave them some way on there. I don't know just how they do that. I've seen them, but I don't remember any way that they weave them then. And they make maybe about an inch wide.
I wonder if there's any of those left in the Iowa.
Huh?
You think any of the Iowa have any of them?
Yeah.
Who would have one?
Huh?
Who would have a necklace like that?
Well, Iowa, not just that. I'm trying to think who it was last when I seen here not too long ago, and I think.
Really? An Iowa?
Mm-hmm. And that.
Who could it be?
Well, I don't remember who it was now around there. Anyway, there's
one down there, huh?
Yes, around there. And then they also have other beads on there. Now you take things like that, I don't know what become.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that when anyone dies, well, they just put them on.
And bury them with them.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
I think that's where a lot of that stuff went around there.
Well, I suppose
and
that's
I still think, I'm trying to think of this fellow who it was had one. It's not been too long ago around there when I seen one around there. But they did have things like that around there. But I don't know how much of that stuff here around there, and more around there.
It'd be a good thing to take some pictures of it in color. You know?
Yeah. They
before it all disappears. Before it all goes away.
Yes, because when there is it.
You know those the beaded things you showed me. What do you call those? Blue? You know, with the yarn ends? What do you call those things? About that wide. A strip of beads.
Yeah.
You know, Ned showed them to me.
Yeah.
That night.
Yes, all the beads on there.
Yeah, what are those called?
What
do you do with them? You never told me.
I don't know.
You put them around your arm?
Yeah.
Or what?
They have some here.
Uh-huh.
And then they have some down here on there, below their knee. And some of them down here.
How old did you say those were?
Well, those I had got down there, well, I don't know. They must be over 70 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Because those I got down there belonged to my grandpa, and he had them.
Which grandpa?
Well, I remember he had them when I was just a little boy.
Really?
Uh-huh.
This Ben Hallowell?
Yes.
Hallowell.
Benjamin Hallowell. Mm-hmm. And I still got them yet, but I just don't remember just how. Well, anyway, he had them way before my time. He was telling me too, and you tell me who made that from there? Some real old
lady
made it on that.
Do men ever do beadwork in the Iowa?
Hey.
Do men ever do beadwork?
Oh, yes.
Men and women can do beadwork.
Not every man, but some of them did on that. And the women did too.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. But They all made beadwork on there, and that is the women's on there. Yeah.
Did you ever use porcupine quills for anything?
Well, no. They did have, but they stopped making those when this porcupine quills got scarce. Uh-huh. You know, couldn't get anywhere. They just quit on there. But I don't know where you'd go, but I heard that you still can't get them yet up in Dakotas.
Yeah.
There. Yeah.
The Sioux. There, the Sioux are still doing
that. That's how come they stopped that. Mm-hmm. They did do quite a bit of that on there.
Mm-hmm.
And so in a way, well, there's a lot of things like that on there. It's after it's got so scarce where you can't get the material. Yeah. Even the bees now, you can't go out and get real good beads to them.
What are real good beads? What do they look like?
Well, I don't know where they come from, but I'm putting you out to show you to get one of them.
Yeah.
The difference in the, down there. And there was one place in Kansas City and one place in St. Louis, but I understand that you can't get them there anymore on there.
Are they, are you talking about cut beads?
Yeah, there is some cut beads there. On there, and then there's some just I'd say plain beads
plain
on
there.
Yes, but it's scarce now on there. There's some people not too long ago were asking me where they could find some. I told them I didn't know, and well, the first one to know I could get some for them. I told them I didn't know whether I could or not on them.
You can buy them in Pawnee.
Well, I don't know whether they got them there or not.
I know there's some beads
in
there.
Yeah,
the Pawnee, they might you're doing
have
a lot of beadwork.
Yes. And one time I was in Tulsa and I was asking there for some, but that fellow told me he hasn't been able to get any
not
quite
long,
a while on there. And but if there's any other place, I wouldn't know around there. I think there's an Indian store down here. El Reno, somewhere there on that. That is a herd.
I bet there's some down there.
Yes,
because
there might be some there on there. Yes.
Well, how could you tell a chief from anybody else?
Right.
How could you tell a chief from anybody else?
Chief from.
How could you tell it was a chief in the way he was dressed?
Well.
Your father, for instance, or your grandfather.
They
dress any differently?
Yes, they. In a way they do, and you can tell the way they dress, and in other ways again, you can tell by their ways and actions.
Oh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And other time again, you can put your tail by the way they talk.
How?
Yeah.
How?
Well, the way they talk their language of their tribe, Iowa language, but in their speech, it's a little different.
It is?
Yes. It's all the same, but what I mean by difference, he uses good words.
Good words?
Good words all the way through.
Can only the chief use these words?
Yes.
Only the chief can use those
words?
Yes,
yes.
Really? Like what?
That's
what's
what they
example?
Call chief talk.
Chief
that.
Talk.
Yeah, that's the way I would pronounce it on it.
Can you say a few words in chief talk? Can you do
well,
it?
Well, I can, but I'd rather not right now.
Okay, fine.
Yes.
In other words, the chief had some words that he could use that nobody else could use.
That's right.
That's very important.
Yes. And that's how come they can tell on it. And then another thing, we're talking about wearing feathers. These are war bonnets, as they call them. Everybody calls them that, you know. And there's not everyone who can wear a feather, even at least one feather. They got to gain a title before they. Now, chief is the only one to wear that as the Cold War bonnet, we mentioned while ago, Ronnie.
Yeah.
And then that other headdress, as we mentioned, one feather only, but sometimes two feathers. Well, certain fellows can wear those on them. And then, otherwise, they, as I say, they got to gain the title. They got to make sure to gain the title and be authorized to wear those.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. You see.
Nowadays, everybody wears those eagle feathers.
Yes, everybody. Women's and older can wear them now around there. But
the little boys, there they are with the big eagle feathers.
Sometimes they get full of feathers. You can't.
Can't tell if it's a chicken or a turkey.
And then, just like you're saying, well, there's a little talk, or like I was mentioning about the little chief talk on with these things on there. So I don't know, a lot of the young people, they don't know and understand. And I know they don't, of course, a lot of them has told me on there.
Mm-hmm.
So they just like to wear them, that's all on there. They see some others wearing them.
They all wear eagle feathers now. Yeah. All the dancers I've seen.
Yeah. But the principal side of the whole thing, there's a little talk goes with them, I think, on there. So that's where it goes on there.
Okay.
Now, then coming down, as you ask, well, go about the food. Well,
you know what? I think